Ladies and gentlemen, this is the first of a series of lectures on British history in the 20th century. And I thought it might be worth beginning by looking at the year 1900 and looking at how it differs from the present time. Because these are things we tend not to notice because our history is so evolutionary. We have the same institutions that we had over 100 years ago, the House of Commons, the House of Lords, the monarchy, and so on. But they have very different functions today from what they did then. And of course, over 100 years ago, we had general elections as we do now, but they were very different from what they are now. And the first and most obvious difference in the year 1900 is that I think fewer than half of you in the audience would have had the vote in 1900. Certainly, no female member of the audience would have the vote. But not all male members of the audience would have the vote either. Women, I should say, could vote in local elections. That was thought to be women's business, to deal with education and local matters, but not with the great matters of the nation and the empire. But not all men had the vote either, and you had to qualify as a male to have the vote. And there were a number of different ways of qualifying. There were seven different ways of qualifying. Most of them connected with property, that the main qualification was a household qualification. You had to be a householder, but there were also various qualifications for lodgers. And broadly speaking, around 60% of adult males had the vote in 1900. And to put it another way, out of 40 million population, 6.5 million had the vote. I should say those 6.5 million, 73,000 were classed as illiterate voters and had to be guided. So anyone who has a golden age view of educational standards, even amongst that 6.5 million, there were quite a large number of illiterates. Now, the movement in the 20th century was away from, of course, from these different ways of qualifying for the vote to one simple way of qualifying for the vote, namely to reach the age of 18. And the vote is now thought of, I think, as a right of citizenship. But it wasn't then thought of in that way. It was thought of as a privilege to be derived largely from a connection with property. And we've moved from the year 1900 to the present time, from a diverse franchise, seven ways of qualifying for the vote, to a simple franchise, just one way of qualifying for it. But as regards the electoral system, we've moved in the opposite direction from a simple electoral structure to a much more diverse one, because in 1900, all elections were carried out by the first-past-the-post system. But today, of course, we have a large variety of systems, and if you live in London, you're used to no fewer than four different electoral systems. The first-past-the-post system for electing members of parliament, the regional list system of proportional representation for electing members of the European Parliament, a different system called the additional member system of proportional representation for electing the London Assembly, and the supplementary vote for electing the Mayor of London. So there are four different systems. In 1900, there were just one system, so we've moved in the opposite direction in terms of the electoral system. Now, women were first given the vote in 1918. Women over 30 with a property qualification. But women over 21 were not given the vote until 1928. So we must be careful and qualify it carefully if we say that Britain was a democracy in 1900. It was far from being that. And indeed, from one point of view, it was less democratic than Germany or France, because they both had universal male suffrage. We didn't. But the effect of the various restrictions on registration were not, I think, so much to keep out what you might call the working class, because the majority, I think, of trade unionists had the vote in 1900. It was to keep out primarily young men living with their parents who didn't have a property qualification, and the itinerant, people who were very mobile and therefore did not get on the electoral register. Now, as I say, from one point of view, we were less democratic than Germany or France. But from another point of view, we were more, perhaps not democratic, but more liberal with a small L, because we were the only country in Western Europe, apart from the Scandinavian countries, where the government was fully responsible to the legislature. In other words, where the legislature, if you like, controlled the government. I mean, Germany, federal Germany, had a parliament elected by male universal suffrage, but it did not control the Chancellor of Germany, the equivalent of the Prime Minister, roughly, or the military, or the army, or the Kaiser. So Germany did not have a system of responsible government that we had. Now, I've shown that not everyone had the vote. Not even all men had the vote in 1900. But there's a further anomaly in the system, that some people had more than one vote. There was what you call plural voting. Indeed, you could acquire as many as 7 votes. You had an extra vote according to your place of residence. So if you lived in 2 different constituencies, you had houses in 2 different constituencies, you had 2 votes, and so on. You had an extra vote if your place of business was in a separate constituency from where you lived. That gave another vote. And all university graduates, there weren't many of those days, 44,000 roughly, they also had an extra vote for university constituencies, which were non-geographical constituencies, and you voted for an MP there. In 1918, legislation was passed ensuring that no one had more than 2 votes, but up to 1918 you could have up to 7. In 1948, plural voting was abolished, and the university seats came to an end. They were abolished by the post-war Labour government. The effect of plural voting, as you could imagine, was to benefit the Conservatives, and it gave the Conservatives a small number of extra seats at each election, about between 10 and 12, I would guess. It's not clear, but a very small number of extra seats. There was also a strong maldistribution of representation. Sorry, that's an ugly phrase, but I hope you appreciate what I mean, especially as the present government is producing a bill to equalise constituency boundaries. But then there were no proper procedures of redistribution. And Ireland in particular was overrepresented. I should explain, and I'm going to talk about this more later on, that Britain then included the whole island of Ireland, because Ireland didn't become de facto independent till 1922. But Ireland was very strongly overrepresented because her population had declined, partly through famine and partly through emigration through the 19th century, but there hadn't been any redistribution. And politicians were rather frightened to reduce the number of Irish seats because of hostility from the Irish nationalists. So a vote in Ireland was worth much more than a vote in England. And you had some very small constituencies in Ireland. At the most extreme, a vote in Kilkenny was worth 20 times a vote in Romford. The Kilkenny constituency was 1/20th the size of that in Romford. There weren't proper redistribution procedures introduced until 1918. Now, I said Britain included Ireland. What was Britain? First included Ireland. But secondly, if you'd asked people at that time what was Britain, they'd have said that Britain was an empire. Now, at this time, 20% of the world was part of the British Empire, and that's in land area, and 23% of the population of the world part of the British Empire, perhaps the main difference between then and now. And this was the largest land empire the world had ever known. There were about 40 million people living in Britain at that time, in 1900, but the empire comprised 400 million people. Now, of those 400 million, 300 million lived in India. And India was ruled directly from Westminster. There was a Secretary of State for India in the cabinet, and there was a Viceroy or Governor General of India, but India was ruled directly from Westminster. It had no real representative institutions at this time. Part of India, of the 300 million people living in India, 67 million lived in what were called the princely states, run by various Maharajas, which the largest was Hyderabad. And they had a certain degree of domestic autonomy, but they could not make decisions in matters of foreign policy or defence. They were made in London. And in 1914, when Britain declared war, on behalf of 300 million people in India. And you may say that Britain was concerned about problems of Serbia or Belgian neutrality, but what had that to do with India? But anyway, India was at war. And there were various other colonies in Africa and Asia, which were also ruled directly from London, indeed much of Africa. And at that time, it's fair to say, most people, even on the left in politics, did not think that self-government was appropriate to people who didn't have a white skin. And people on the left thought at some very distant date in the future, possibly India might have self-government, but they didn't think that Africa really ever would. They were ruled directly from Westminster. Now, there were another set of countries in the empire which had become self-governing in domestic affairs, and they were on their way to independence, and they were the so-called colonies of settlement, Australia, Canada, and New Zealand. And there was one colony of settlement where there was a clash between British settlers and Dutch settlers, the so-called Boers, and that was, of course, South Africa, and 1900 was in the middle of the Boer War. And in that year, it seemed that Britain had won the war fairly easily, and a general election was held by the government to capitalise on that, a khaki election, if you like, but it then seemed that victory wasn't as easy as was thought, and the war lasted till 1902 because the Boers defeated in the field, perhaps the first country to adopt guerrilla warfare and to show what could be done with that. And that's very important in British history because it first exposed people's worries that they might not be strong enough to retain the empire. People began to get worried about British weaknesses in the field if they couldn't defeat a small group of ragged farmers. It's worth noting that in the Boer War, Britain wasn't fighting alone, but for the first time, countries from the colonies of settlement voluntarily sent troops to help the British. The Canadians, the Australians, New Zealanders, was the first sign of a strong imperial sentiment which was to be there in both world wars. But as I say, the Boer War did not end until 1902, and it seemed to expose very serious British weaknesses. Britain was also, and here there is something similar to the present day, Britain was also engaged in Afghanistan, trying to defeat tribal problems, and I think one prime minister, I think it was Harold Macmillan, said the first rule in politics is never get involved in Afghanistan. But we were involved there at that time in a rather futile attempt, perhaps, to defeat the guerrillas there. Now, the government which presided over this war and which was re-elected with a very large majority in 1900, sometimes called a conservative government. And the Prime Minister was certainly a conservative, a strong conservative, Lord Salisbury. And he was the last peer to be Prime Minister. And after that, it came to be accepted that a Prime Minister had to be in the House of Commons. His cabinet was very aristocratic. 9 of the 20 members of it were also peers. 2 others were baronets. 1 was the son of a peer, and 1 was a nephew of a peer. And many members of the cabinet, and also of the junior ranks of the ministry, were in some way related to Lord Salisbury. And the left nicknamed his cabinet the Hotel Cecil, because the Salisbury name was Cecil. Now, Lord Salisbury was ageing, and was succeeded in 1902 by, you won't guess, his nephew. Arthur Balfour became Prime Minister. And Salisbury's first name was Robert, and the phrase "Bob's your uncle" comes from that. That Arthur Balfour was a why was he Prime Minister? Because Bob's your uncle. That was the answer. But although the Prime Minister Salisbury and his successor Balfour were both conservatives, it was not a wholly conservative government but, and this is some similarity to the present day, a coalition government of conservatives and another group who were called the Liberal Unionists. Now, the Liberal Unionists were a group of liberals who'd broken away from the main branch of the Liberal Party in 1886 in protest against Gladstone's proposal to give home rule to Ireland. And so the name of the government, it was not a Conservative government, it was a Unionist government, a Unionist coalition, if you like. And the breakaway of Liberals in 1886 had the consequence of making the Conservatives the dominant grouping in the country. But between 1886 and 1905, there were just 3 years of Liberal government, and that a minority Liberal government dependent upon the Irish nationalists. Now, it's important to note this Unionist coalition was based on a negative proposition, namely that home rule should not be given to Ireland, that the union between Britain and Ireland should be maintained. And probably in that government, although we don't have opinion polls, we don't have opinion polls till 1937 when Gallup opened its offices in Britain. Although we don't have opinion polls, it's very probable that the most popular figure in the government was not a Conservative, but a Liberal Unionist, namely Joseph Chamberlain, the Colonial Secretary. Now, there's no Colonial Office now, of course, but when we did have one, it was seen as a rather minor ministry. But in those days, it was seen by many, and certainly by Chamberlain, as the key ministry in the government because it controlled the destinies of the empire. And after Chamberlain broke with Gladstone in 1886, perhaps he thought he wouldn't hold office again, but he confided to his wife that if he ever did hold office again, the post he would like to have would be Colonial Secretary. And in 1895, when the Unionist government of Salisbury was formed, Chamberlain was offered by Salisbury whatever cabinet post he wanted, and he chose the Colonial Office. And it was Chamberlain primarily who gave to the government its character as a popular imperialist government. And Chamberlain was the person probably most identified with the Boer War, who gave the Conservatives their great victory of 1900. And this, I think, is an important motif of the 20th century. It's very much the Conservative century. Conservatives in power most of the time. In the 20th century, there are only four occasions when you have large left-wing majorities. 1906, when you've got a Liberal landslide. 1945, with Attlee's Labour landslide. 1966, with Wilson. And 1997, with Blair. Now, for much of the rest of that time, nothing could be done which the Conservatives didn't want done. The Conservatives were in control for much of the 20th century. And they won a number of landslides. In 1900, through Joseph Chamberlain. In 1918, after the First World War, with Lloyd George. And in 1931, with the formation of the National Government under Ramsay MacDonald. Now, Chamberlain and Lloyd George and MacDonald were called many different things in their political careers, but no one ever thought they were Conservatives. Nevertheless, they helped to give Conservatives very large majorities, and it may be that the coalition today will have the same effect, we don't know. But it does show the Conservatives were a very adaptable party. They had the ability to reach out to others who were not Conservatives, and that's an important reason for Conservative success. Now, Harold Macmillan once said, rather mischievously, that the last purely Conservative government was that formed by Disraeli in 1874, because every other Conservative government has had accretions from the left in it, like the Liberal Unionists, or the Lloyd George Liberals after the First War, or National Labour Party following MacDonald in the 1930s, the Liberals in the 1930s, and so on. The Conservative success is because they've attracted people from the centre and the moderate left. That's an important reason for their success. Now, I said that for much of the 20th century, nothing could be done that the Conservatives didn't want done. But even when you had left-wing majorities in this period, the Conservatives still had great influence because they were the dominant force by far in the House of Lords. Now, of course, the House of Lords at that time was composed completely, purely of hereditary peers, no women in the House of Lords, of course, at that time, hereditary peers, plus the bishops and the law lords, who didn't play a major role. But the Conservatives were very, very dominant, particularly after the split in the Liberal Party in 1886. And one sign of Conservative dominance was the vote on Gladstone's second Home Rule Bill in 1893, because that passed the House of Commons, but in the Lords it was defeated on a straight party vote by 419 votes to 41 votes. So the House of Lords at this time was the equivalent of a one-party chamber. Whoever won the election in the Commons, the Lords were very, very strongly Conservative, and in 1909 there was a clash with the government over Lloyd George's People's Budget, which I'll talk about next time. And that led to a restriction on the powers of the Lords. But in 1900, the powers of the Lords were, in law, absolute. They were equivalent to those of the Commons. By convention, the House of Lords did not interfere with money issues. And that was the matter that came to a head in 1909. But in law, the powers of the House of Lords were absolute and in no way restricted. So there was a tremendous Conservative bias, if you like, to the Constitution at that time, even apart from the voting relationship to property. Now, the opposition at that time was not the Labour Party, which of course it is today. The Labour Party had just two seats in the general election of 1900. I'll explain why in a moment. But the main party of the left were the Liberals. And they faced a very difficult problem after the retirement of Gladstone, their great leader, in 1894. And I think one can only compare it with the problems the Conservatives had in recent years after the retirement of Margaret Thatcher. That after a very powerful leader who leaves his or her imprint on the party, there's always the problem that other potential leaders have been squashed, and that really you don't know where the party is going to go next. What should be done? Should you preserve Thatcherism or go beyond it? Similarly, should you preserve Gladstone's legacy or do something different? Very difficult with a dominant leader. How do you move on? Now, Gladstone himself was very much against what he called construction, and we would call that state intervention. He was very much against that because he thought he was a rather right-wing liberal from some points of view. Indeed, Margaret Thatcher once said that if Gladstone had been alive in the 1980s, he'd have been a member of her administration. But Gladstone believed that any state intervention undermined individual independence and individual choice and should be restricted. Liberalism for him meant primarily constitutional and moral reforms, home rule for Ireland, devolution for Scotland and Wales, reform of local government, reform of the licensing laws, a very strong liberal cry at that time, didn't make them particularly popular, temperance legislation, and so on. Reform of the House of Lords, weaken the powers of the House of Lords against a liberal government. And Gladstone was also against imperialism, intervention abroad. He thought it was rather vulgar and expansionist, and countries shouldn't be always seeking to expand their territory. Now this, whether he was right or wrong, left the Gladstonians rather out of touch with the new spirit of the end of the 19th century, beginning of the 20th, where ideas of state intervention and imperialism were growing. And there was a reaction against Gladstonianism, and people said we need more intervention at home to deal with very serious social problems, poverty, ill health, and unemployment. And we also need much more intervention abroad to strengthen the empire and Britain's position in the world. And gradually, during these years, you've got the development of what was called the New Liberalism. And the New Liberalism says the state must play a much more active role than it has in the past, can no longer simply hold the ring, but a greater degree of state intervention is needed to deal with evils. Use the state. Now, another great difference between 1900 and today is that if you were an ordinary law-abiding citizen, and I'm sure everyone in the audience is law-abiding, you wouldn't notice the state at all. You would hardly have any dealings with the state. There was no national insurance till 1911. There were no old age pensions till 1908. There were really no state benefits in the modern sense. Your only contact with the state you'd be if you were a person of some means, you'd pay income tax, so only a minority of the population really paid that. So you could go through your life, as it were, without knowing that the state existed. And that was all to change in the new century with the legislation of the Liberal government returned in 1906, and then perhaps an even greater change, the effects of the war, which led to conscription and the state mobilizing the whole of society to win the war, because the First World War turned out to be a very different war from the Boer War, or for that matter, the Crimean War, because the Boer War, the Crimean War, were small wars fought by groups of professional soldiers. The First World War was a very different and new sort of war. It was a war fought by large masses of people. You needed a large amount of manpower, and that meant conscription. But even more than that, you couldn't win the war unless the factories were producing armaments at the right rate and other things needed for the front. So in a sense, the person at home working in a factory was of as much importance to the war effort as the soldier. And this led to the legitimization of trade unions. It led to women being given the vote, because many women were co-opted into the factories. It led to direction of labor and all sorts of changes, nationalization of major industries that would not have been thought of in peacetime. So war was a great centralizer. War, as it were, a great friend of the state. But as I say, in 1900, you would hardly notice the existence of the state at all, a very different world from today. Now, of course, one central change in the 20th century is the replacement of the Liberals by the Labour Party as the main party of the left. And you may argue, well, doesn't this go along with the rise of the state? Weren't the Liberals perhaps too much immured in traditional philosophies and not really attuned to the use, the creative use of the state to meet difficult problems? Or perhaps the Liberals couldn't adapt to a world of universal suffrage. As I said, we had limited suffrage in 1900. Or some people say it was a result of bad luck, contingent factors, the First World War, the split and the quarrel between the followers of Asquith in the war and the followers of Lloyd George. And now I want to talk about these matters later. Historians still argue about them. But what's clear, I think, is that I don't think anyone in 1900 would have thought that the Labour Party would overtake the Liberals. Now, I should say, in 1900, the Labour Party wasn't called the Labour Party. It was called the Labour Representation Committee, and it changed its name to the Labour Party in 1906. And the Labour Party was actually formed in 1900 in February in a meeting at Farringdon Hall. And it was formed fairly shortly before the general election, didn't really have time to get its troops, as it were, ready for the general election. It wasn't in a very strong position, which perhaps why it returned only two candidates. And those two candidates were returned because the Liberals didn't oppose them, so they didn't win any seats against the Liberals. Now, the Labour Party, or the Labour Representation Committee, as it was a very different animal from what it is today. It was a federal party composed of three different elements. There was, firstly, the Independent Labour Party, not to be confused with the Labour Party. Sorry, I hope this isn't confusing. The Independent Labour Party, called the ILP. Now, the Independent Labour Party was a socialist party founded by Keir Hardie, the man with the cloth cap, you remember all the deer stalker and so on, founded by him in 1893. Now, a lot of people, including some historians, overestimate the support this party had. It had very few members. Socialism was not very popular at that time in Britain. It had about 7,000 members in 1900, and that was smaller than the membership of the Conservative Party in any large city in Britain. A very small number of people were socialists. Then the second element in the Labour Party were the socialist societies, of which the Fabians were the most important, and they of course still exist. But again, although they had a lot of influence, one shouldn't exaggerate their numbers. There were only about 700 members of the Fabian Society at this time. There weren't a large number of people. But they did have a great influence, intellectual influence. You couldn't, in those days, join a constituency Labour Party as you do now. You could only join the Labour Party through one of the constituent elements, that is, the independent Labour Party, the Fabians, or the third, by far the largest, most important element in the Labour Party, which was the trade unions. Now, you'll appreciate that the ILP with 7,000 members was not going anywhere. And the problem for any people who wanted the representation of the Labour interest was, firstly, they couldn't get the numbers, and secondly, they couldn't get the money. And therefore, they relied for both of those on the trade unions. And the significance of the Independent Labour Party was it was the only one of those small socialist parties, you could call it socialist sect, if you like, that was actually prepared to work with the trade unions. The other socialist groups took a rather purist view, perhaps they were right logically, but it didn't help. They said in a socialist society there's no role for independent trade unions. It's a planned society. We don't want trade unions. We're not going to work with them. And they also said, what was true, that the trade unions were not themselves socialists, and most trade unions were not at that time. Now, the main concern with the trade unions then as today was with their members' interests. And at this time, in 1900, Britain was in the middle of a depression, and the employers wanted eagerly to cut costs. And one way in which they tried to cut costs was to bring in non-union labour, in particular into the railways, but also into other industries. This was a period of what's been called the employers' offensive against the unions. And this offensive was buttressed by the courts, which perhaps the judges are much less liberal than they tend to be these days. And the courts said that the trade unions were liable in tort for any actions undertaken during a strike. And this threatened trade union funds, which they'd built up many years, and threatened what the trade unions thought was a secure position that they'd attained in British society of being recognised. Indeed, the legislation recognising unions had been passed by Disraeli's Conservative government in the 1870s, but that position was now under threat. And the unions had to decide what to do about it. This, I think, is very interesting about the trade unions, that they tended to act together in the 20th century only when their position was under attack. What they were doing in 1900 was not trying to make gains, but to defend the status quo, defend the position which was under attack. Now, in 1926, in the general strike, the TUC supported the strike. It wasn't trying to make gains, it was trying to defend the status quo. They were fighting against a reduction in the wages of miners. They weren't seeking an increase, they were just saying miners' wages should not be reduced. And similarly, in 1974, I think, in the strike which ended the period of the Heath government, they were fighting to retain differentials which were already in existence. And this is something important, I think, about the role of organised labour in the 20th century. It's at its strongest when it's on the defensive. But that is the only time when there will be strong union or working class solidarity. At other times, it doesn't exist or tend not to exist. And that was certainly the case in 1900. And the trade unionists said to themselves, what are we going to do about the employers' offensive? And their answer, I think, was a very characteristically British one. They said, we have to put this right in Parliament. They said, the right way to deal with any problems is in Parliament, the House of Commons. But we face a difficulty, they said, because our representatives aren't in the House of Commons. The employers have lots of representatives in the House of Commons, both the major parties, Conservatives and Liberals, lots of employers there, but there aren't any people who speak up for the organised working class. And therefore, the trade unionists said, we need people of our own, we need a part of our own, who can speak up for this interest that is being neglected in Parliament. And they looked around and they said, well, there's already a party in existence which will work with us. The socialists have one, the ILP. And so they said, we'll join with them and form the Labour Representation Committee, which is later the Labour Party. But they said to the ILP,
will only join if you forget all your nonsense about the class war and put socialism after distance. We're not interested in that. What we're interested in is these immediate matters and repairing the position of the trade unions, which they succeeded in doing by putting pressure on the Liberal government that came to power in 1906. We're not interested in ideologies. All we're interested in is improving the position of working people. So it's vital to note, and a lot of people get this wrong, I think. They look to a golden age of the Labour Party when it was genuinely socialist. And Tony Benn, I think, is particularly liable to do that, was talking about Keir Hardie and so on. It was not formed as a socialist party. It was formed as a party to deal with immediate practical interests. Indeed, it did not have a creed of socialism until 1918, and many of the trade unionists and many of the leaders were not socialists at that time. It was a party to represent the working class. The key feature of it was representation and not ideology. And I think that is fundamental to it. Now, it was formed in February 1900. I had a meeting in Farringdon Hall. And it wasn't noticed much in the newspaper, wasn't reported much, though one very prescient newspaper man said that this was a cloud no bigger than a man's hand, which could grow to something very large and important. Now, at the beginning, a small party, obviously under our electoral system, could easily be smashed by the other two parties. Very difficult for small parties to get off the ground. But the Labour Party had a stroke of great luck that the Liberals were willing to help them by making an electoral pact. Of course, electoral pacts are in the news now, but there was an actual electoral pact between the Liberals and the Labour Party. Now, why were the Liberals willing to help? The reason was they'd been in opposition for so long, they couldn't believe they'd ever get to power again. They couldn't foresee the landslide in 1906. If they could have foreseen the future, they might well have smashed the Labour Party there and then, which they could easily have done by putting up candidates against all Labour candidates. But of course, like the rest of us, they can't foresee the future. So they said, we could be in the wilderness forever, but we can get working class and trade unionist votes if we have an electoral pact with the Liberals, with the Labour Party, beg your pardon. And there was a secret pact in 1903. It wasn't made public, though I think a sensible observer could guess that there was such a pact. It was much helped by a feature of the electoral system then, that you had a number of two member seats. So one candidate could be Liberal and another Labour. The single member constituency only became complete in 1948. At that time, there were a number of two-member seats. So it was helped by that. And there was, therefore, a pact. And again, one shouldn't look on Keir Hardie as a pure-hearted socialist. He's perfectly happy to have a pact with the capitalist party. Indeed, without that, the Labour Party would never get off the ground. And most of the Labour seats in 1906, when they won 29 seats, and in 1910, when they won, there were two elections, they won 42 and 40 seats, respectively. Most of their seats were won through Liberal aid. They wouldn't have won many without the Liberals. The Liberals didn't appreciate the danger. They could have crushed the Labour Party. Now, so far, I've mentioned three parties, the Conservatives. Well, really, I suppose four. The Conservatives, the Liberal Unionists, the Liberals, the LRC, Labour Representation Committee. But there was another party in Parliament, frequently called the Irish Nationalists. It called itself the Irish Party. And this party was a consequence of the extension of the vote in Ireland. Because by legislation in 1884, the agricultural labourer in the whole of Britain was given the vote. And given that Ireland was primarily an agricultural country, this made a tremendous difference in Ireland. So that you can say the general election of 1885 was the first quasi-popular election in Ireland. It wasn't fully democratic, but quasi-popular. And of the 103 seats in Ireland, the Irish Party won 80. Now, outside Ulster, the Irish Party won every seat but two. The two they didn't win was the university seat of Trinity College Dublin, which was primarily a Protestant university at that time and not sympathetic to nationalists, and the constituency in Dublin where the English residents and rulers lived, in the Rathmines. But they won every other seat. They got about two-thirds of the Irish vote. And their leader, charismatic leader who died young, called Charles Stuart Parnell. My Irish friend said it's pronounced Parnell. Some people pronounce Parnell. But anyway, Parnell or Parnell, he said in 1885, there was just one plank on the Irish platform, and that was Home Rule, the establishment of an Irish Parliament in Dublin, what we now call devolution. It wasn't clear whether devolution was meant as a step to independence or not. And the statue, I don't know whether it's still there in O'Connell Street in Dublin, there's a statue of Parnell, and underneath it is his famous statement. He said, under the British Constitution, the most that we can ask for is our own Parliament in Dublin. But then his famous statement, but he said, no man can limit the march of a nation. So the question was devolution merely, or home rule rather, merely a means on the way to independence, or was it, as it is perhaps in Scotland or Wales, we don't know, an alternative to independence? But anyway, the Irish said, we don't want to keep any MPs in Westminster, unlike the SNP. We don't want any MPs, and we don't want that. We want the Parliament in Dublin. And so the Irish MPs were sent to Westminster to say, we don't want to be here. We're here to say we don't want to be here. And this is a problem for a liberal state, because after all, people said, well, let's see what the opinion of the public is. The opinion of the Irish was, we don't want to belong anymore, we don't want to be here. And difficult for liberals, because they said, if you're liberal, you say, well, self-government, Australia, Canada, all very well, but what happens when it's on your own doorstep? And when Gladstone proposed his first Home Rule Bill in 1886, it was defeated, as I said earlier, by a breakaway of the so-called Liberal Unionists led by Joseph Chamberlain. In 1893, there was a second Home Rule Bill, which I said got through the Commons but defeated in the Lords by 419-41. And Gladstone at that point said that he wanted to dissolve Parliament and take the issue of the peers versus the people to the country. But his colleagues wouldn't let him because they thought most people in the country were opposed to the Irish, so Gladstone shortly after resigned. Now, it's difficult, I think, at this stage to understand the opposition to Home Rule, but I think you can't underestimate it. It was very powerful. Firstly, people said, this is an age of great empires. Germany's recently been united, a great empire, large Russian empire, America, a large country, competitor to Britain. This isn't the time to be breaking up countries. America almost broke up in the Civil War, they said. It was held together by force. For the same reason, we should hold Britain together, even by force if necessary. It's worth remembering that Gladstone, who favoured Home Rule for Ireland, was also in favour of the independence of the South in America on grounds of self-determination. Joseph Chamberlain took the side of the North, on the ground that great empires shouldn't be broken up wantonly, and that was the view he took about Britain. Then people said, this is a surrender to violence, because the Irish nationalists, or some of them, adopted violent methods, militant methods. Then they said, and I think one can't underestimate this at the time, that Ireland would be a Catholic country, and Britain was then a profoundly Protestant country, in a way difficult to imagine now, that tolerance was given to Catholics and other sects for that matter, but you were very much a guest in the house. Britain was a Protestant, basically a Protestant country. And then people were worried about Ulster. They said, what about the northeastern part, which is strongly Protestant? They don't want to be ruled by Dublin. And if you say that Dublin has the right to hive off from Britain, doesn't Belfast have the right to hive off from Dublin? Similar problem. So Home Rule was rejected in 1886. And people reply, the Irish said, we don't want to be here. But the reply was, you don't really mean it. You do want to be here, really. And the Conservative policy was to... There were two policies, really. The first was what they called killing Home Rule with kindness, to establish various social reforms in Ireland, local government reform, reform enabling more people to acquire their land and so on, to undermine the demand for Home Rule. But second, another Conservative proposition was 20 years of resolute government. If you show authority, then the Irish will realise they do really want to remain in Westminster. And it did mean, of course, ruling Ireland against the wishes of the population. Very difficult for a liberal state to do. But British politicians, you may say, in a rather futile way, spent 36 years trying to reconcile Ireland to the British connection. It failed, and in 1922, Ireland became in effect independent. And at that point, the Unionist coalition ceased to call itself Unionist, because, of course, they had failed to save the Union. They called themselves again Conservatives. And by 1922, as Ireland became independent, they had to go much further than Gladstone had gone in 1886, without winning the goodwill that Gladstone had hoped to win. It was a sad failure. But meanwhile, with the Irish at Westminster, they tended to block proceedings in the House of Commons. And because of the presence of the Irish, in seven elections between 1886 and 1914, three resulted in hung parliaments, because given the Irish had between 80 and 85, 86 seats in every election, you need about 100 seats more than the other party to have a working majority. And the Liberals tended to be dependent on the Irish vote. And moreover, you may argue that the Irish issue proved a distraction from other more important matters which a British statesman could have been thinking about. So it's a sad failure. Gladstone once said that Ireland was the one example of the failure of the British political genius, and I think that is true. Now, as I said, the Unionist coalition had been formed in 1886 for a single negative purpose, to oppose Home Rule. But Britain, under the Unionists, faced great challenges in the world, and in particular, as I said, the rise of new empires that were challenging Britain's industrial supremacy, commercial supremacy, and also, perhaps, her military and, even more important, her naval supremacy. Particularly, people began to get worried about Germany. And until the beginning of the 20th century, Britain had a position of what was called splendid isolation. She had no allies, no alliances with people, needed none. And that came to an end with the new century. In 1902, Britain signed her first alliance with, of all countries, Japan. And that was because Britain and Japan had a common interest in resisting Russian expansionism into Asia. That was the first alliance. In 1904, not quite an alliance, something more informal than that, but the Entente Cordiale with France, making up with the ancient enemy and establishing better relations. And then in 1907, an Entente with Russia, who was France's ally. So gradually Britain became absorbed into an alliance system in Europe. But that didn't solve the commercial problem that Britain seemed to face: the fear of British decline economically, as her rate of growth was falling, the rate of growth of other countries was increasing. What was the answer to that? Well, when people looked at the new developing empires, Germany, America, Russia, France, they found they all had one thing in common. They all had strong tariff policies, that is, customs duties against goods, imports produced by the foreigner. And this, some people thought in Britain, was very damaging to Britain, because it meant we couldn't sell our exports to these countries. And we had a flood of imports from those countries, whose labour costs, so some people argued, were much lower than those of Britain. Their goods, some people said, were poorer quality. They were flooding the British market and putting British people out of work. Now, where could Britain look for help? Now, there was one area where it was clear, and the Boer War had shown it, that we could look for help, and that was the self-governing colonies of the Empire, Australia, Canada, and New Zealand. And some people were beginning to argue that if we were to meet the challenge of these new empires, we had to bring the empire more closely together ourselves. We had perhaps to get defence cooperation from the empire, perhaps leading to some form of imperial unity. Now, that was a step too large at the present time, and the self-governing countries, having got self-government, weren't easily persuaded to merge their defence with Britain. But perhaps a first step could be taken in terms of economics, in terms of economic self-interest. Suppose the empire got together as a unit and imposed its own tariff with preferences given to imperial goods. The empire could become an economic unit that would challenge America or Germany or France or Russia and impose a tariff, as other countries had done, against goods from abroad, but giving preference to goods from the empire. And in March 1903, Joseph Chamberlain, the key figure of the government, made a powerful speech in Birmingham, which one of his supporters said it was like Luther at Wittenberg, because Chamberlain was challenging what was an ideology, a dogma, if you like, of Britain since the Hungry 40s. Chamberlain was saying, free trade is no longer the way forward for Britain. We must abandon free trade if we're going to survive in this new world of gigantic empires. And Chamberlain cast his speech in the form of a demand for an inquiry. But everybody knew it was more than that, that it was a call for a totally new policy. And he said, if we had an imperial tariff with preferences, we could achieve all the things that I mentioned, and we could also, perhaps contradictorily, we could use the money gained, the revenue gained, for social reform, in particular for introducing old age pensions. Now, this was a tremendous challenge to everything most people in Britain held dear, and Chamberlain realised, I think, that it wouldn't be easy to persuade people to accept what he was proposing. So he resigned from the Conservative or Unionist government and said he would lead a campaign in the country to try and bring opinion round to his ideas. And from the next few years, he stumped the country, a remarkable achievement for a man of his age. He was then 67, which is older then than he is now. He went round the country speaking in favour of tariff reform. But this policy, it did not only split the country, but it split the Unionist coalition. And Chamberlain's opponents begged him not to raise this issue, because if you do, you will split the Unionist coalition and you will then bring a Home Rule government into power. So by bringing up the issue of tariff reform, you'll break up the United Kingdom. You'll bring a government which is going to disintegrate the United Kingdom into power in Westminster, which is precisely what happened. It split the Conservative Party and reunited the Liberals, because whatever else the Liberals disagreed about, and there are lots of things, they all agreed free trade is the Ark of the Covenant, you mustn't tamper with it at all. And it also, I think, brought the country round to the Liberals, because people had a folk memory, perhaps inaccurate, who knows, but a folk memory of the so-called Hungry 40s, before the repeal of the Corn Laws, when, so it was said, people were starving because bread was so expensive. And the main cry the Liberals had in the general election of 1906 was that tariff reform means dear bread. It means a rise in the cost of living for the working classes who pay the cost of the tariff. Now, the Liberals won in 1906 as decisive a landslide as the Conservatives or Unionists had won in 1900. It's important to note, although it proved to be one of the great social reforming governments of modern times, and I want to talk about this in my next lecture, this victory was won on a negative. And just as the Unionist coalition had been held together solely by a negative and broke up when a positive was introduced, the great liberal victory was not won on any positive proposals for social reform, which would have divided people very considerably. It was won on a great negative. Don't go back to the Hungry 40s. Resist tariff reform by electing a Liberal government. So it appeared that liberalism had won a great victory, and with it a number of supporters of the Labour Party brought in. But perhaps all this was just as deceptive as the Unionist victory of 1900, because this great Liberal government of 1906 was to lead Britain into the First World War, which you may say ended not only the Liberal Party, but with a small l, a certain liberal civilization that had existed before the First World War. In other words, the death of liberal England was shortly to come about, entered into by the Liberal government returns so triumphantly in 1906, on the whole a fairly pacifistically inclined government of the left. Paradox, perhaps, you may say paradox like Blair in Iraq, but got into this terrible war which destroyed both it and, in a sense, liberal civilization. But I shall discuss these matters in more detail in my next lecture, and particularly the period of social reform entered into by the Liberal government, which really began to create the modern welfare state, which perhaps the present Liberals may be in the process of beginning to dismantle, we shall see. But that'll be for my next lecture, which is in November, I think. Thank you.